Welcome to Walking the Haftarah. I'm Tyler Merwin, and this is Torah portion, Acharimut. This week's Torah portion is Leviticus 16:1 through 18:30, and our Haftarah this week is Amos 9:7 through 15. Acharimut means after the death, as the opening line of our portion that reads, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they drew near before Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh and died. Leviticus 16:1. This week's Torah portion will be part one of a double portion when read in non-leap years, read with Torah portion Kedoshim. This week, there are differing traditions on which half-Torah portion to read, but we'll be covering Amos 9:7 through 15. But depending on where you get your source, it may give you a different alternative. So let's begin with a review of this week's Torah portion. Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they drew near before Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh and died. And Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh said to Moses, Tell Aaron your brother not to come at any time into the holy place inside the veil, before the mercy seat that is on the ark, so that he may not die. For I will appear in the cloud over the mercy seat. Leviticus 16:1 and 2. Our portion begins by describing the Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement service. Seeing the direct connection here of the death of Nadab and Abihu to how the high priest Aaron is to approach the Holy of Holies seems to possibly hint at the source of the violation that may be brought about their deaths, though there are many other speculations. He, the high priest, shall put on the holy linen coat and shall have the linen undergarment on his body, and he shall tie the linen sash around his waist and wear the linen turban. These are the holy garments. He shall bathe his body in water and then put them on. Leviticus 16:4. These garments are plain white linen, but they're referred to as holy or sacred. The high priest's regular garments, the one with all the bling bling, are described in Exodus 28, and they are said to be made for glory and for beauty. One of the reasons for this is that the Kohen Gadol was Adonai's representative to the people. So his garments represented the glory and the beauty of the Holy One himself. But here, on Yom Kippur, he is representing himself and the people to Adonai, and before him, we have no glory of our own. This is approaching our king and judge with humility. Aaron begins by offering a bull as a chatat, which is a sin offering, for himself and for his household. Two male goats are chosen and lots are drawn, one goat for Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh and the other for Azazel. The blood from the bull of Aaron and the goat of Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, that is for the people, are sprinkled on the ark and then on the brazen altar to provide atonement for the sins of the people, because these sins contaminate the tabernacle throughout the year. The goat of Azazel is sent into the wilderness after Aaron lays his hands on it and confesses all of the iniquities and sins, and even says rebellious sins, of the people. Remember that the sacrifices are known as korban, which means they are to draw near, and they ascend to the Holy One for that purpose of drawing near. Our sins and our iniquities are not offered and cannot ascend to the Holy One. Instead, they are removed far from Him to be lost in the wilderness forever, which is through the goat of Azazel. And it shall be a statute to you forever that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, you shall afflict yourselves and shall do no work, either the native or the stranger who sojourns among you. For on this day shall atonement be made for you to cleanse you. You shall be clean before Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh from all your sins. It is a Sabbath of solemn rest to you, and you shall afflict yourselves. It is a statute forever. Leviticus 16:29 through 31. Yom Kippur is the most holy day of the year. It's a day of fasting, which is what is meant by afflicting your souls. But it's also a day of great joy, because our Creator brings us another fresh start. Yeshua's sacrifice is eternal, as His sacrifice affects the heavenly altar, not just the earthly. But we still live in an earthly sinful world and rely on His shed blood along with our repentance to bring our annual renewal each Yom Kippur. Next, we get a prohibition of sacrificing animals away from the tabernacle, which was apparently happening at this time. Now that the Mishkan had been established, this is the only place that's acceptable to make an offering to Adonai. Some were even sacrificing to pagan deities out in the wilderness in their encampments, as we see where Adonai commands, "So they shall no more sacrifice their sacrifices to goat demons, after whom they whore. This shall be a statute forever for them throughout their generations." Leviticus 17:7. Next, we are told how to deal with the blood of an animal. "If any one of the house of Israel or of the strangers who sojourn among them eats any blood, I will set my face against that person who eats blood and will cut him off from among his people. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement by the life. Therefore, I have said to the people of Israel, no person among you shall eat blood, neither shall any stranger who sojourns among you eat blood." Leviticus 17:10 through 12. So many pagan rituals involve doing this exact thing, and there are many commandments that prohibit misbehaving or mistreating the blood, like eating the blood, drinking the blood, or even covering yourself in blood. Being covered by the blood of Yeshua should not invoke these kinds of images to us. Adonai commands the priest to sprinkle the blood, such as in the ordination of the priesthood, where Moses sprinkled the blood on Aaron and his sons, and on the people at Mount Sinai, where Moses sprinkled the blood out onto the people to sanctify them. The covering that was made was spiritual. The best picture, I believe, for this is the Passover lamb that was sacrificed in Egypt, which of course represents Yeshua. And the blood was applied to the doorpost and the lintel of the home. That blood covered the obedient family from the death of the firstborn. Now, the firstborn was not physically covered in blood. Matter of fact, no blood was actually put on him at all. But that blood is what covered him for protection, and that whole family was covered by the blood that was on the doorpost and lintel. That should be the picture we have when we hear the term covered in the blood. Any blood of an animal that is spilled is to be poured out on the ground and covered over with the earth. And then Adonai reiterates these rules are both for the native-born and the stranger who sojourns among you. And Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to the people of Israel and say to them, I am Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh your God. You shall not do as they do in the land of Egypt, where you lived. And you shall not do as they do in the land of Canaan, to which I am bringing you. You shall not walk in their statutes." Leviticus 18, 1-3. Adonai tells them not to follow the customs of where they came from, which was Egypt, or where they're going, which is Canaan. Then we get into chapter 18, most of which covers forbidden relationships. These statutes are chukim, or commandments that are beyond human intelligence. They are the "because Daddy said so" commandments. Those of us that live in Judeo-Christian societies see the list of relationships as being unkosher or kind of repulsive to us. But most of that's because our society that we grew up in is actually based in biblically moral standards, even though that seems to be going by the wayside lately. Other societies, though, even today, don't prohibit many of those relationships we see in this chapter. Then they are told not to offer any of their children to Molech, the Canaanite god. Homosexuality and bestiality are also prohibited. Do not make yourselves unclean by any of these things, for by all these things the nations I am driving out before you have become unclean. And the land became unclean, so that I punished its iniquity. And the land vomited out its inhabitants. But you shall keep my statutes and my rules, and do none of these abominations, either the native or the stranger who sojourns among you. For the people of the land who were before you did all of these abominations, so that the land became unclean, lest the land vomit you out when you make it unclean, as it vomited out the nation that was before you. Leviticus 18:24-28. This brings us to our Haftorah this week, which is Amos 9:7-15. Amos was a shepherd and a prophet at the end of the era of the northern tribes of Israel. He was from the town of Tekoa, which was in the territory of Asher. He was a contemporary with the prophets Hosea, Isaiah, and Micah. This portion is also the very end of the book of Amos. Are you not like the Cushites to me, O people of Israel? Declares Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Did I not bring up Israel from the land of Egypt, and the Philistines from Kephtor, and the Syrians from Kir? Behold, the eyes of the Lord Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh are upon the sinful kingdom, and I will destroy it from the surface of the ground, except that I will not utterly destroy the house of Jacob, declares Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Amos 9:7-8. Our Torah portion ended with the warning that Israel was not to act like or to follow the customs of the pagan lands around them, where they came from and where they were going to. But here, judgment is coming because Israel has done exactly that. It has become the same sinful kingdom. The kingdom will be destroyed, but the people will not all be destroyed. For behold, I will command and shake the house of Israel among all the nations as one shakes it with a sieve, but no pebble shall fall to the earth. Verse 9. The exile of the 10 tribes of Israel by Assyria have literally shaken them across all the nations of the earth as it is to this day. All the sinners of my people shall die by the sword, who say, disaster shall not overtake or beat us. Verse 10. These are the ones who ignore the prophets and believe that there is no accountability for their sinful behaviors. These are the very ones whom will be destroyed and not simply exiled. In that day, I will raise up the booth of David that is fallen and repair its breaches and raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of old, that they may possess the remnant of Edom and all the nations who are called by my name, declares Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, who does this, verses 11 and 12. Now Amos switches focus to the future messianic restoration and redemption. The Sukkah of David refers back to when Israel, all of Israel, was under a united King David and later his son Solomon. This will be King Yeshua, who is from the line of King David, who will repair all that was destroyed in the Messianic era. Edom is Esau, the red one, representing the beast and the beast system. These nations will all be dispossessed by the righteous in those days. Behold, the days are coming, declares Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, when the plowman shall overtake the reaper and the treader of grapes, him who sows the seed. The mountains shall drip sweet wine, and all the hills shall flow with it. Verse 13. The sages see this as a prophetic fulfillment that even exceeds the original found in Leviticus 26, verse 5, that says, your threshing shall last to the time of the grape harvest, and the grape harvest shall last to the time for sowing, and you shall eat your bread to the full and dwell in your land securely. But here in Amos, harvesting and sowing are happening at the same time. The bounty is actually continuous, not seasonal. The blessings of the land will be great. I will restore the fortunes of my people Israel, and they shall rebuild the ruined cities and inhabit them, They shall plant vineyards and drink their wine, and they shall make gardens and eat their fruit. Verse 14. The land is good, and we will one day soon enjoy its fruit in complete peace. I will plant them in their land, and they shall never again be uprooted out of the land that I have given them, says Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, your God. Verse 15. When Yeshua returns and brings us home, we will never have to fear exile again. We serve an awesome Elohim, and He has everything that we need. He's bringing the two sticks together into the hand of Yeshua, our Savior and King, where we will all be under His sukkah, the fallen sukkah of David. May it be soon and in our days. I pray this teaching has been edifying. Let's lift up the name of the Holy One. With love, in Echad. Shalom.